everybody. How you doing? Good morning, good morning. How was your week? My week was awesome. If you had any challenging stuff going on in the week, just know that God is able and he's still with you in spite of it all. If you do not mind, be upstanding as we get into the presence of God, as I lift the name of Jesus up. So if you can be upstanding, please. Raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than my unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. Lift it up, y'all.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
The King is alive. Yeah. I'll raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I'll raise a hallelujah. I'll watch the darkness flee. I'll raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery.
Yes, sir.
I'll raise a hallelujah.
Is
a
king is alive.
only one person, and his name is Jesus.
Saves me so much better.
as a group lift up the name of Jesus, lift up his praises. It's always so just joy-filled.
Yes.
And when I hear the voices and I hear the clapping and I see people moving and just obviously experiencing and engaging with him, it's just, it's something so singular that you can't get anywhere else.
Yes.
And I think sometimes we get wrapped up in this, you know, we experience worship on Sundays and then we go about our week and we don't experience worship until we come back the next Sunday. And I fall victim to this all the time, where I just kind of let my week be what it is and I don't connect with God and engage with God in the way that he deserves and in the way that I would like to. And so, you know, we raised our hallelujah. We declare him a defender and a victor in our lives. And I just want to encourage all of us to do that, not just today, but do it tomorrow, do it Tuesday, Wednesday, and so on. And just keep doing that in our lives and watch the evidence play out before us. Watch the barriers lift out of our path. Watch the burdens lift off our shoulders as we declare him the victor of our lives throughout every single day, throughout every single moment. And that doesn't have to be singing. You know, I'm not asking you to break out into song in the middle of grocery shopping, but, you know, if it's helping a neighbor, helping a friend, if it's getting down on your knees and praying, or just, you know, sending up a thanks to God on your drive, you know, to your commute, just anything that just, you know, any way you can connect with that worship, I just really encourage all of us to engage with that as much as possible. And so in that spirit, as we go into this next song, we talk about all the miracles God has done in our lives, the little ones that add up, and, you know, just how are we even here? It's all of the miracles that he's done in our lives. So just let's marinate on that as we continue worshiping together.
Nothing short of a miracle, I'm here. I got some blessings that I don't deserve. I've got some scars, but just how you learn. It's nothing short of a miracle, we're here. Think it over and it doesn't matter. I know it comes from above. I got miracles, oh miracles, a million little miracles. Thank you, Jesus. Miracles, oh miracles, count your miracles. One, two, three, four, I can't even count them all. Yeah.
There's three.
You held me steady so I wouldn't give up. You opened doors that no one could shut. I hope I never get over what you've done. I wanna live with an open heart. I wanna live like I know who you are. I hope I never get over what you've done. I think it over and it doesn't matter. I know it comes from above. I got miracles on miracles, a little miracles.
It's pretty easy not to say, come on.
Miracles are miracles. Count your miracles. One, two, three, four. I can't even count. I got miracles are miracles. A little miracles.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, oh.
Miracles are miracles. Count your miracles. One, two, three, four. I can't even count them all. I can even count them all. I can even count them all. 1, 2, 3, 4, I can even count them all. I can't even count them all. You my brother,
I can't even count them all.
You redeem my sister,
I can't even count them all.
Even in the death of my brother,
I can't even count them all.
1, 2, 3, 4,
I can't even count them all.
You broke my chains,
I can't even
you saved my life,
count them all.
You took me from
the
painful place. God has done for you will make you run out of time, because He is just God all by Himself. He has made us strong even in our challenges and our weaknesses. He has given us a place to call home even when we don't have anywhere to call home. We can literally be in a house but not have a home. We can literally be with people and still be alone. So not feeling alone, knowing that God is with you, is a blessing. And the second blessing I can think about is I'm just alive. I'm breathing in air. I'm able to sing. That's another miracle. And the big ones is the ones that you come on stage and they just tell you that, hey, you got a big breakthrough. Oh, hey, you are the big person next to do something big in the world. Those are big miracles, but then there's nothing bigger than the little ones that we face every day. The depression, the anxiety, the stress, the arguments, the bickering. It's been a miracle to fight with your spouse, with your partner, and still hold on steadfastly to the love that God has given you as a household. To be able to resolve conflict is a miracle. To be able to even be in a conflict and not lose your mind is a miracle. So let's just count our miracles and know that God is always doing something for us, even if we do not know. It doesn't have to be a big on stage. Everybody can see that you're great. When you're in your private place, I want you to know that those times that you're struggling, it's also a miracle to stand steadfastly in the faith that God has given you. That is a miracle. Some people just lost their lives because they couldn't handle it. But we have a God. That is a miracle. So as we're ending this worship, I want you to just go home thinking, this is not planned. If you can turn off the music, this is not planned when we're worshiping. I just feel like you guys need to hear this. I need to hear this, that the miracles we have been underrating for quite some time now. We should snap out of it. Even to feel pain and still keep going, it's a miracle. To the day God will actually heal you or not, and then there's ultimate healing when you go to heaven, that is a miracle. We never lose. Even no matter what the devil throws at us, it's a miracle that we are still standing here. So I want you to just reflect just for 30 seconds and we can transition. All the little miracles, the ones that have been mentioned, the ones that has not been mentioned, you know you and your family, you know you individually.
just think about it for 30 seconds and just say thank you at the end of it all for the miracles, the little miracles. Jesus, we thank you so much for a wonderful time of worship. As we transition in, we pray that you take total control. Let your spirit take ultimate control. In Jesus' name. The word that is coming, let it fall on nourished hearts, hearts that are willing to receive, and let it change something on the inside of us. We don't want to remain the same like we came. In Jesus' name.
Go ahead and take a seat. Good morning. Welcome to Point Church Garner. Whether you're watching online from halfway across the world or here in East Garner, we want to make sure you feel welcome. And we're so glad you're here. We're glad that you answered the call from God to show up and have an experience with Him. So we have a connect card, and that's how we keep track of who comes, and we can reach out to you and give you more information about the church. And there's a place on here to encourage you to try 5 visits. And we ask you can't get to know a family in just 1 week, and we consider this to be our family. So please try to come 5 times, and we'll stay in contact with you. And if this isn't the right church home for you, we'll help you find a church home. There's also a place on here to write down prayer requests or ways that you'd like to get involved with the church here. So take a minute and fill this out. Give us your address. We won't spam you. We'll just keep in touch with you. And if you have a prayer request, you can pray at the end of the service with one of the elders. But the elders meet every week on Thursday to pray over the prayer requests. So don't be hesitant to put in your prayer requests or go back for prayer at the end. There's lots of information in the bulletin that you received whenever you came in today, but there's also more to know. So we're going to go through the rundown, and we're gonna tell you more. But if it is your first time visiting, please stop at the Big Blue Square and get a Chick-fil-A gift card. Thanks for coming out today.
And welcome to Point Church Garner. We're so excited that you're here. Now that summer is in full swing, we're excited to let you know that on July 9th, we're starting a series called Summer of Psalms, where we'll be exploring 4 different psalms and their relevance to our lives. We know that the summer is often a time of travel, so when you're in town, make sure to join us. And don't forget that you can watch any service you missed by going to pointchurch.com/sermons. As we continue in our worship service, we want to invite you to worship through giving. Giving to Point Church is making an investment in what God is doing in this world. When we as the church live generous lives, we get to see the impact that God can have on a community. For example, just a few weeks ago, we recognized our Rooted graduates who completed an intensive 10-week discipleship group. These graduates read daily devotions, met for group discussions, prayed and fasted together, and even served at a local homeless shelter. Hearing their stories was a testament to what God has done in their lives. If you would like to give to what God is doing in our midst, you can go to pointchurch.com/give and select the Garner campus. Or if you prefer to use your phone, you can text give, add a dollar amount, to 77977. It's quick, easy, and you can feel good about making an eternal impact. To stay up to date with everything you just heard, head on over to our news page by visiting pointchurch.com/garnernews. We hope you enjoy the rest of today's service.
All right, good morning, Point Church. Happy summer, right? I think, was it this past week was the first day of summer? Am I right? Yeah, I see some head nods. All right, so I'm not crazy. Well, we are so glad that you are here. Like Dan said, if you're a guest with us this morning, we just want to extend a special welcome. And you came for the 4th week in our series called Stories, where we are looking at the stories of Jesus, often called parables. And we're trying to explore the impact that these ancient stories can have on your story. Now, this morning, I think we all know what it's like to prepare for a big occasion. If you think back to your wedding day, you know there was a lot of preparation that went into that. If you think back to school and the preparation for a big exam and the anxiety you had around that and how much work went into that. And my wife and I, we have been doing some renovations on our home. And it's been fun. It's been good. We've been learning a lot, making a lot of mistakes. And one thing that I've learned that's, I guess, pretty par for the course in any sort of home renovation is in one day, you very well may go to Home Depot or Lowe's 3 or 4 times for something that you forgot, right? Like there's a tool or something you said, I knew I needed that. Or maybe you thought, wow, why, when I was gathering all my stuff together, why didn't I pick up this specialty nail or whatever it is? And so you become really good friends with all the cashiers there because you're going so often. But whatever it is, you can think back to a time where you know what it's like to prepare for something. In fact, the ancient Chinese philosopher Confucius once said, success depends upon previous preparation, and without such preparation, there is sure to be failure. In this final week, as we're going through our last parable, what I want you to see is the importance of preparation. But not just any preparation, but preparation ultimately for the culminating moment in human history, which is the Lord Jesus' return as he comes back to us. Specifically this morning, we're going to be looking at that, looking at a fairly well-known parable known as the Parable of the 10 Bridesmaids. Sometimes it's called the Parable of the 10 Virgins. Those words were sort of used interchangeably. And so we're going to be looking at a great wedding that some of the bridesmaids were prepared for and some of them weren't prepared for. But before we get into that, just for a little bit of context. So this story that we're looking at talking about Jesus' return in the Gospel of Matthew actually comes as part of what is known as the Olivet Discourses. So that's sort of a technical word to talk about all of these stories and teachings that are speaking into the reality of Jesus' coming back. And so this one story is sort of a particular facet of it. And so if you have time, if you take time and you look at Matthew 24 and chapter 25, you'll see how these different stories each speak to a different reality of Jesus' homecoming. But this morning we're going to be looking in Matthew chapter 25, starting in verse 1. And again, what I want you to see this morning is what Jesus has to say about his homecoming and how the preparation we can have for his return can impact every area of our life. And so if you don't have your Bibles with you, the words are going to be up here on the screen. If you don't have a Bible at all, we'd love to be able to give you one. So please see myself, see somebody in a blue shirt. We'd love to give you one so you can take God's word with you wherever you go. So we're going to be in Matthew 25, starting in verse 1. This is what Jesus says. Jesus says, "At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Now, 5 of them were foolish, and 5 were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps, but did not take any oil with them. The wise ones, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. Verse 5, the bridegroom was a long time in coming. They all became drowsy and fell asleep." Let's just pause real quick. So if you're not familiar with Middle Eastern customs, this is not abnormal, even today. But back then, weddings were a big deal. They were a big deal, and it's sort of strange because we think in our Western minds, weddings are usually pretty planned out, right? So there's a time for the ceremony, then there's a time for pictures, and there's a time for eating, and then a time for the reception, and it's all sort of orderly. But in ancient Middle Eastern culture, weddings were sort of an ebb and flow event. They didn't have as much of a strict regimen as we do today. And so when someone was to be wed, the groom, when he would come, his arrival wasn't at a specific time. So the bridesmaids would come over, and they'd bring instruments or food or whatever it is to the bride's house, and they would wait with her. And they would wait and they would entertain, and sometimes it might be an hour, sometimes it might be half a day, sometimes it could even be more than one day. Nobody knew the exact time that the groom would arrive. For some of you, that sounds like a nightmare, right? Like, what? I mean, I've got places to go, got people to see. We've got a plane that's going to leave for our honeymoon. Like, I need something. But that's how it was. It was very ebb and flow. But when the bridegroom came, all the party got started. And it was such a big event in that culture that friends and family and the whole village would be invited to this wedding feast. If you were poor or you were middle class Israelite, well, you didn't have a lot of money to go on vacation or maybe go to the big city or really have any sort of big party, but the one time in your life you did make an exception for that was a wedding. And it was something that everybody benefited from. And so it was this exciting, it was this huge event. And here Jesus is using this, a very normal, very common custom, to say that there were these bridesmaids who came to be with the bride. And their job was to be with her until the groom came. And because it could happen at any point in the day or night, they brought along their lamps. And as Jesus says, there were five who brought oil. They remembered to bring oil with them, but there were also five who didn't. Well, he continues in the story in verse 6. He says, at midnight, right after they had fallen asleep, at midnight, the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish one said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out." "Oh, no," they said. "There may not be enough for both of us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves." But while they were on their way to buy oil, the bridegroom arrived. And the virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. "Lord, Lord," they said, "open the door for us." But he replied, "Truly, I tell you, I don't know you." Therefore, Jesus says, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour. So what Jesus is saying here in this story is you have some of the bridesmaids who were well prepared for the Lord's return. They had their oil. They knew no matter rain or shine, night or day, we're going to be ready. But the five foolish virgins, the five foolish bridesmaids, weren't prepared. So when the bridegroom comes, and as was normal, a herald came before the groom and would yell out, he's coming, everybody get ready, he's coming. Well, they woke up and realized, oh, I'm not ready for his coming. And so we see sort of how this unfolds. We know what it's like to be prepared, and I think most of us know what it's like to be unprepared. If you've ever given birth before or had a spouse that has given birth, you know there's a lot of preparation that goes into that, right? Like you've got to pack the bags. You're like, okay, well, if the water breaks at any moment or if the baby's going to come, like the baby's not waiting for anybody, so I've got to make sure my little bag is packed. So maybe you put a change of clothes, maybe put a book or, you know, your charger, whatever. You make sure that little to-go bag is ready. And so then in a moment's notice, you can get up and go. Because sometimes the baby doesn't wait very long. Sometimes you get a little bit of a head start. If you have an induction, it's a little calmer. But at other times, if the baby's coming, it's coming. I read one story about a woman who gave birth on a New York subway late at night. That sounds like a terrible environment. And somebody else, a woman gave birth prematurely on an airplane that was flying to the Caribbean. And the baby just came. No stopping. And so they had a baby over the ocean, and they had to figure out, well, what is your citizenship? Anyway, and that was a whole question for them. But as the due date approaches, you know, as parents, you've got to be prepared. You've got to be prepared. I think the overarching meaning of Jesus' story is that we have to be prepared. We do not want to be one of the foolish bridesmaids. We don't want to be left out in the dark. We don't want to be begging others for help when we know well enough that we should have been preparing all along. So what does this look like? What does it mean to be prepared? I mean, we could end there and say, hey, you know, Jesus says be prepared, and we could go on our way, but what does that really mean? Like, what does that look like? What is this really teaching us about preparation? I think the first thing that this teaches us, and I think this is fairly obvious, but it's a good place to start, is that you are responsible for your own preparedness. You and I are responsible for our own preparedness. No one can prepare for us. Right? No one can go out like a parent and say, "Well, I'm going to get your stuff together for you." That happens when you're a kid because, well, you don't know what you're going to need. You know, when we go on summer vacations, our kids don't really know what they're going to need, so your parent takes care of you. But there are some things that you just can't have somebody else prepare for. Again, looking at verse 7 in this text, Jesus says, "Then all the virgins woke up and they trimmed their lamps, and the foolish ones said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil. Our lamps are all out. We don't have enough. We're unprepared.'" And they said, "No." Not because they're being mean, right? They weren't just being jerks. They said, "No, there may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, why don't you go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourself?" Sometimes when there was a wedding, stores would stay open extra late because they knew that some of the people coming to the wedding wouldn't be prepared. So what does it look like? What does it mean then to be prepared? If we're responsible for our own preparation, what is Jesus saying that we need to be responsible for? Well, I don't think that the oil in this parable means something specific. Some people have tried to make, well, the oil, you know, the oil means you need to do X or Y or Z. But I think at a basic level, to be prepared for the Lord's return, it means that we are responsible for getting right with God before his return. That we are responsible for bringing our sins and saying, "Lord, you take them because I can't take them on myself. I've messed up and I've tried for so long. You know, maybe I've swept them under the rug, but I know that sooner or later I'm going to be held to account for what I've done or what I haven't done." Right? There are some things you can't borrow. You can't borrow someone else's talent. You can't borrow someone else's character, and you cannot borrow someone else's relationship with God. And I think what's interesting is when the five foolish bridesmaids come after they get their oil, they come and they knock on the door, right? And they say, "Let us in, let us in." And he says, "I don't know you." And you think that's kind of strange, right? Like, I don't know. I mean, this is part of like the bridal party. Shouldn't you at least like sort of know? Like, "Oh, you're so-and-so's daughter," or "What's your name? I've seen your face," right? But he says, "I don't know you." And I think the reason why he's saying that is because to know somebody in that culture meant to have an intimate relationship with them. To know them was a form of intimacy. And so it wasn't an intellectual, "I don't know you," right? Like, "I don't know who you are." It could also be, I know who you are. I know what your name is, but I don't know you personally. And I think it's a reminder that for those bridesmaids, they didn't know the groom personally because they didn't care enough to be prepared for his coming. He says, "No, you don't belong here because you didn't care. I don't know. You don't have a relationship with me. If you did and you knew how important this was, you would have made sure there was oil in your lamp." And so if we want to be prepared for the Lord's coming, we need to know him. You see, and the cool thing about that is that the Lord doesn't say, "You have to know all these things about me. You have to be able to use really big theological words and express these concepts in sophisticated ways." He says, "No, that's not what it is. I just need you to know me. I've put myself out there, Lord," said, I came and made my dwelling place on earth. I sent my people out. I've built my church. I've sent it out. I've proclaimed it from the rooftops. That I want a relationship with you, that my son died to bridge the gap between your sin and perfection. And I've done everything in my power to say, "Come, come, come." And so if we reject that, it's not on him, it's on us. And what is the Lord's response to that? "Well, I don't know you. I don't know you. I put myself out there, but if you choose not to take it, that's on you. I don't know you." There are some things you just can't prepare for. Or excuse me, there are some things that only we can prepare for. We are responsible for our own preparation. But what else? What else? So if we are responsible for our own preparation, I think that's pretty clear from the text. Well, what else does that mean? Well, I mean, what else does this teach us about preparation? Well, I think the second thing that this parable also teaches us is that the best preparation that we can do, the best preparation is faithfulness. It's faithfulness. Like, how can we think, we look at this and we say, well, how can I be faithful to prepare for the Lord's return? Well, like I said, some of that is to say, okay, well, I need to make sure that I'm right with God, right? Which is nothing of our own doing. We don't make ourselves right with God. We just come and freely accept that relationship that God's put out. He says, "I love you. I want a relationship with you. I'm not going to bar you from that. I just want you to come." And so we say, okay, at a minimum, well, that preparedness looks like accepting the free forgiveness of the Lord and entering into a free, gracious relationship. But I think there's also more to it than that. We can go beyond that. In a different parable that Jesus gives in this Olivet Discourse, in the last chapter, Matthew 24, Jesus gives a parable about a servant and a master who goes away and he leaves his household to his main servant. So he says, you got to provide for the other servants. You have to take care of the animals. You have to take care of everything. And he says, this is what a faithful servant looks like. And in Matthew 24, verse 45 and 46, he says, a faithful, sensible servant is one to whom the master can give responsibility for managing his other household servants and feeding them. Right? In other words, doing his job, being faithful to what the master required of him. And he says, if the master returns and finds that the servant has done a good job, well, guess what? There'll be a reward. Right? In other words, a faithful servant is somebody who can be trusted. It's somebody who perseveres in their calling even when it gets difficult. They obey even when it's inconvenient. They treat others well. And there's a reward as a result. I mean, I don't know. Sometimes if we don't get that. That when Jesus comes and he sees us living faithfully, of course we don't earn our salvation, but God says, look, like there's a reward for that. Like your faithfulness will go beyond the grave, or the results, the reward of your faithfulness will go beyond the grave. In fact, in a different parable, just a little bit after ours, in Matthew 25, he says this. It says, his master, speaking of a similar example, he says, his master said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things, and so I will put you in charge of many things. So share in your master's joy. As followers of Jesus, I think most of us, we long to hear those words. Like, that's what we want. When Jesus comes back, we just want him to say, good job. Like, I'm so proud of you. Well done, good and faithful servant. And sometimes we can chain ourselves to our calendars, or we can chase bigger and bigger accolades, forgetting who it is that we are ultimately trying to please. We can get so caught up in playing the game that our society lays before us that we forget that we've been given a different rule book to play by. There's an illustration I like from a man named Randy Alcorn. He's an author, a Christian author, and he tells this story or uses this as an illustration. He says, imagine you're back in the Civil War, and imagine that you're a northerner, that for one reason or another you're living in a southern state. And so maybe you were down there for business, and then the war broke out, and so you're sort of trapped there. You can't really get back, but you want to get back to the north. And he says, also imagine that for some reason, you know, beyond the shadow of a doubt, you know that the north is going to win. Okay, so you've been living in the south. You know that the south is going to lose. The other thing, though, is that from living in the south for so long, from doing your business there, you've accrued a large amount of money, except it's in Confederate currency. Now, if you're smart, if you're wise, you'll think to yourself, well, pretty soon this currency is going to be worth nothing, right? Like Confederate currency is going to be worth nothing when the Confederacy loses. And so what would you do? Well, you would probably, if you were smart, you would take, maybe just set aside a little bit about for what you need to make it to the end of the war, and then you would take your lump of savings, and you exchange that for U.S. currency. And then he says this. He says in his book, he says, as Christians, you have inside knowledge of an eventual worldwide upheaval caused by Christ's return. This is the ultimate insider trading tip. Earth's currency will become worthless when Christ returns, or when you die, whichever comes first, and either event could happen at any time. And in other words, we would be foolish to invest all of our time and energy and attention on the things that won't last. That's not to say that things that don't last are necessarily unimportant, but it does mean that we place a different value on them. That the Lord is returning, and when he comes, do we want to hand him things that in the moment seemed valuable, right? Like, well, I might have neglected my relationship with you so that I could become really good at basketball, right? Or because I wanted a really big bank account. You know, I mean, do we want that to be what we offer the Lord when he returns, or do we want something else? I think living a life A faithfulness striving to please God will not only pay out in this life, we won't only see the fruit of our faithfulness in this life, but more importantly, we will see the fruit of it in the life to come. You and I are responsible for our own preparations, and again, the best preparation, I believe, is faithfulness. Now, what we could do is we could end right there, and I think that would be a pretty good understanding of the parable, but there's something else that I think is subtle, but I think it's extremely important. Sometimes when we look at this story, we focus so much on the bridesmaids who didn't get in, right? Because our heart yearns for them. Like, we want everybody. We're very inclusive, right? Like, man, we want everybody to be a part of the party. And so then when we see the five bridesmaids who didn't get in, that sort of draws our attention. But there's something else in the story that ought to fill us with a lot of hope and a lot of encouragement. I want you to look again at verse 10 real quick. Jesus says, "But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the foolish bridesmaids, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut." So again, remember, this is a wedding, and this is one of the biggest events in that culture that a poor person could attend, right? That the one excuse they had for a massive feast and a massive festival was a wedding. When the Lord comes again, it is going to be the ultimate celebration of which we are invited into. It is the ultimate celebration for which you and I, as followers of Jesus, are invited into. And it's because of that preparation that return becomes a joyous event instead of a tragic one. It's because of our anticipation for the Lord's return that event becomes something that we long for, that we look for. And so that's why the last thing that I want you to see, if you're taking notes or if you're just absorbing it, is this, is that as followers of Jesus, we can wait with excitement and anticipation. We can wait with excitement and anticipation. How many of you have ever been in a situation where your mother or your father said something like, you know, just wait till your dad gets home, or just wait till your mom gets home? Yes, I see that hand, Teresita. I've been there too, right? So you do something, and your mom says, just wait till your dad gets home. And it's funny because as I've gotten older, my dad said one time, he always hated when my mom did that because he wanted his homecoming to be a good thing instead of like, just wait till dad comes home to punish you. But that was the worst, right? If you made mom so mad that she had to go to dad, that was a terrible thing. And so, you know, right, if you mess up, and it doesn't just have to be with that, it could be, you know, go to the principal's office. I mean, you could use anything, but you know what that's like. There's a feeling, I've done something wrong, and I'm going to get punished for it. If you were told to clean your room and you didn't, if you saw that vehicle coming in the driveway, you pop up and you start cleaning your room real quick. Of course, but they can always tell when you haven't done it, right? I mean, because it looks like a half-done room. But imagine that situation another way. Imagine that instead of getting in trouble and your mom saying, just wait till your dad gets home. Imagine for a moment that your dad was deployed overseas and he had been gone for years. But he was about to come home and your mom looked at you and said, just wait till your dad gets home. That phrase takes on a whole new meaning, doesn't it? It goes from a sense of, oh no, like there is a terrible judgment, there is wrath coming my way, to I just can't wait for my dad to get home. I just can't wait. I'm so excited. We're going to meet him at the terminal, right? Or he's going to walk out of that airplane. I can't wait to give him the biggest hug. And suddenly, your dad's return becomes something that you can't wait for, that you've been dreaming about, that you've been anticipating for years. And when we look at Jesus' coming, yes, Jesus gives us very stern warnings. He says, you got to be prepared, right? You don't want to be distracted. You don't want to just distract yourself to death or live a life that is just full of these distractions. And when Jesus comes back, you're like, here's a couple of things, I guess. You know, there's a couple of things I have to offer you. No, you say when he comes back, it's, oh, my dad has come home. To be reunited with his family. Jesus' return is a joyous event. That's why the early church used this Aramaic phrase, you might have heard it before, called Maranatha. They would say to one another, Maranatha, Maranatha. And what that means, it means, come, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord, come. It would end their prayers with it. They would use it as sort of like a secret code during the days when they were persecuted. They would say, "Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus." Because in a season of life, in a society where they were treated as less than, man, the best thing for them was to say, "Come, Lord Jesus." And our society might be a little bit different. We may not face the same level of persecution, but do you say with the same longing and anticipation, "Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. Oh, come back. Come back to me. I'm ready." And I guess that leads to another question. Are you ready? Are you ready? Again, at a foundational level, regardless of whether we've been faithful or not, if we come to the Lord and we say, "Lord, I've messed up. I need your forgiveness." He says, "Come, welcome in. I know you." Right? "Come into my party." The worst thing that can happen is he says, "I don't know you." So do you know him? But then more than that, beyond that, man, don't you, when he comes back, don't you want to stand before him and give him something and you say, "Lord, this, I've devoted my life to your good pleasure. Here's what I have to offer." Not comparing it to what somebody else has done. Not comparing it to what the life that somebody else has lived, but you said, "Okay, with the cards that I am dealt with where I am, Lord, I give it all to you." It's like the widow's mite, right? Where Jesus tells this parable of, he says, a widow came in and she was destitute. She was poor. She had nothing, but she came in and she gave just a little small coin. She dropped it into the synagogue bucket. And Jesus says that woman gave more than everyone else because she gave all she had. By outward appearance, it wasn't much, right? It was a penny. It was a dime. It was a quarter. It was nothing. You maybe could buy a piece of gum with it, right? I mean, it was like that. But he says, no, that she was living in more faithfulness than anybody else because she gave all she had. So it's not about what you give. It's how you give it. So what are you giving with your life? Whether you have a lot or a little, what are you giving with your life? And when the Lord returns, are you going to feel confident in saying, "Lord, I gave it all. Welcome home, Dad. I gave it all." Because he gave it all for you. So together we can say, "Come, Lord Jesus." If you came in this morning, you should have received a communion packet, and I want to invite you to take that out. Communion, in a very real way, reminds us not just of Christ's death, but it also, believe it or not, reminds us of his coming again. In fact, Jesus, when he's with his disciples, and he holds up the bread and he says, "This is my body broken for you." And he holds up the cup and he says, "This is my blood which is spilled for you." He also tells them, "I will not take this banquet with you again until I return." And so not only do we remember, do we look back at Jesus' sacrifice, do we look back at what he did for us, the freedom and the forgiveness that he offers to every single one of us, but we also look forward to his coming again when we sit in the kingdom of heaven and we're at the wedding feast and we're at the banquet with our Father, with our brothers and sisters in Christ, where there is no, as Scripture says, a mourning or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Behold, Scripture says, he who is seated on the throne says, "Behold, I am making all things new." So as you take communion this morning, if you are a follower of Jesus, I invite you to do this. If not, I invite you just to sit back and think about what you've heard. But as you take this morning, I want you to look forward to that heavenly banquet, that heavenly wedding feast where the bridegroom returns. I want you to think about those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." So church, may we take and may we eat the bread together. May we take and remember his blood, which was shed for us to allow us a future with him. As we continue in an attitude of worship, I want to invite you to stand as we continue to worship. If you would like prayer, if something the Holy Spirit has stirred within your heart and you just want to pray with somebody, myself and our elders, we'll be in the back. We'd love to be able to pray with you. If there's something you want to celebrate, we'd love to celebrate with you. If you want to respond by investing in the kingdom of God, you can do that. You can do that, again, either by giving online or dropping that in the Connect card bucket on your way out. But I just invite you not to leave this moment without responding in the way that God leads you this morning. So will you stand and respond as you feel led?
never been more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you down. It doesn't take a trophy to make you proud. I'll never be more loved than I am right now.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice, carried in the rhythm of the wind to call me out. You would cross an ocean so I wouldn't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now.
You are mountaintop. I can see so clear when the sun goes down. Just stay by my side when the sun goes down. Don't want to forget how I feel right now.
Chosen, I know who I am. I know what you've spoken. I'm already loved more than I could imagine, and that is enough. I'm already loved. I'm already chosen. I know who I am. I know what you've spoken. I'm already loved more than I could imagine. And that is enough.
I'm already loved.
I'm already loved. I'm already chosen. I know who I am. Know what you've spoken. I'm already loved more than I could imagine, and that is enough. If it dresses the lilies with beauty and splendor, how much more will it clothe you? How much more will he clothe you if he watches over every sparrow? How much more does he love you? How much more does he love you if he dresses,
the lilies
in beauty and splendor? How much more does he love you? How much more does he love you? will be content in every circumstance. Jireh, you are enough.
Thank you, Jesus. And thank you guys for coming. Have a wonderful week. And don't forget to drop your Connect card. And Pastor Grayson will be outside in front of the blue, big blue
square.
Yeah. So go out there and then he'll be there. And also there's this Chick-fil-A thing.
Yep. So if you are a first-time guest, we would love to give you a $5 gift card so you can meet Pastor Grayson at the big blue square. Yeah.